Namaskar. Yesterday, in the inaugural session, we were all greatly fortunate to receive the blessings of Paramapavan Dalai Lama Ji. What he told about us about Hinduism and the message that he gave us, if we could resolve to bring Hinduism to that level of the status of Jagat Guru once again, I think most of our problems and the kind of problems I'm going to discuss today will get solved on their own. But that is all the Hindu society will need. Parampavan Dalai Lama Ji also told us that all the religions of the world, they may be superficially different, but in a sense they are one, and all of them are searching for the unity, the one behind the many, which was the original discovery of Hinduism, the original discovery of India. Dalai Lama Ji is of course right, but I often feel that these superficial differences between religions, they historically matter. And one of the differences that I am going to talk about today, that has mattered greatly in history. These two great religions, Christianity and Islam, they differ from others in one particular aspect. And that is that converting others, proselytizing, adding to the numbers, is an essential part of the observance of those religions. It is not subsidiary to that. You, a Christian or a Muslim, is not a good Christian and not a good Muslim till he does not carry the message further, till he doesn't bring others into the fold. This essential nature, one of the essential aspects of these two great religions, which are relatively newer religions of the world, has determined the history of the humanity for the last 2,000 years. Much of the strife that we have seen in history, much of the pain that the large part of humanity has suffered, has arisen from this particular feature of these two large religions of the world, that for them, converting others is part of being religious. It's not just one of the things. You are not a good Christian, you are not a good Muslim, till you do that. How essentially a part it is, I'll try to show. There's this saying by Pope John Paul II. This is a quote from the homily he delivered in the city of Delhi on the Diwali day of 1999. What he said was, just as the first millennium saw the cross firmly planted in soil of Europe, and the second in that of America and Africa, so may the third Christian millennium witness a great harvest of faith on this vast and vital continent. He was talking about us. May the church in Asia heed this message so that all may have life and have it abundantly through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This message of love and hope for the people of the Asian continent, if you would have looked at it, it was also a threat to the people of the Asian continent. It was a threat that what has been done to the people of America in the previous millennium, what has been done to the people of Africa in the previous millennium, we will try our best to do it to you in this coming millennium. This message was delivered at the beginning of the third millennium of Christ, in the beginning of 21st century. Pope John Paul II talks about this, gives his message, this kind of message, is important in itself. Pope John Paul II, as many of us know, is of the modern times. He is one of the most pious Christians. He was called the praying Pope. He was beatified almost immediately after he passed away, and he was indeed a highly spiritual person. He tried to bring together bring lower the strife between the three kindred religions, the Christianity, Islam and Judaism. Nobody would have done in the recent times at the level that he did. He was indeed a great Christian, great spiritual leader, greatly spiritual man. And he was saying this, that we will convert Asia in the third millennium. So that is how much essential this conversion is to Christianity. It is not a superficial feature. It's one of the essential features. If Pope John Paul II can say this, then that is the ultimate truth about Christianity. Is nothing less than that. Now, beyond this, after this, I'll try to show what they have achieved in the course of the 20th century, these two religions, how they have changed the world in the last, particularly in the 20th century, but in the last 2 millennia, the world hasn't changed. These are numbers. There are too many numbers here. Pay attention to only the first two rows, the rows about Christians and Muslims. This Muslims formed 12% of the world in 1900. In 2010, they form about 23%. From 12% to 23%, that is the share of the world they have got. And Christians formed about 1/3 of the world. They form the same about 1/3. But this hides the fact. This 20th century, as all of us know, was a century of loss of hope, loss of faith for most of the Christian world. Many of them became atheist. And also, 20th century, particularly the last half of the 20th century, was the period when rest of the world, the non-Christian part of the world, grew much faster than the Christian part of the world. Once the imperialism was lifted, the rest of the world grew very fast. But in spite of that great growth of Africa and Asia, and much lower growth of the Americas and England, Christians retained their 1/3. And this happened because there was large amount of inroads made into Africa, particularly Africa, and also into Asia. If I just tell you the numbers, out of this, about 6 million Christians, only 5% would have been in Asia and Africa. Out of this 2.3 billion Christians, something like 37% are in Asia and Africa. That is the kind of inroads Christianity made during the 20th century in Asia and Africa. And because they made this such inroad, that the reference in Pope's message to Africa comes from there. Muslims, of course, grew from 12 to 20%. And let me move quickly to the next. I'll quickly give the religious profile of different parts of the world. Africa was only 9% Christian in 1900. It is 48% Christian in 2010. It was 32% Muslims, and there are 42% Muslims there in Africa. The native religion is there, who followed their local religion. There were about 60% in 1900. There are only about 9% left in parts of Africa. African continent in the 20th century has been divided between Christians and Islam. And that is why in that homily, the Pope is referring to Africa, because Africa is the great success story of Christianity and Islam of the 20th century. Actually, physically, it has been divided, Africa. North Africa is 94% Muslim and 5% Christian. And these 5% Christians, there'll be in Egypt about 10%, about 20 million Christians, 10 million in Egypt, about 7-8 million in South Sudan, which, because it had the Christian population, has been separated from Sudan. South Africa and Central Africa have been taken over by Christians. 83% South Africa, 80% in Central Africa. West Africa and East Africa are divided between Islam and Christianity. I don't have the time, but because these are divided between Islam and Christianity, there is contention everywhere. There are big bloody quarrels taking place there, bloody strife taking place there, because Christians and Muslims have not been able to settle their scores there. The problem is going on. Incidentally, in East Africa, Uganda and Kenya are largely Christian now. It's only Somalia which remains free of Christianity, more or less. And that continues as a problem. I think you have to give me one more. When you started 11, now let me quickly go to Asia. That was Africa. In Asia, Christians were about 2% in 1900. They're about 8% now. And Muslims were about 16%, and they're about 26%. These are not small changes. These are millennial changes. When the proportion of a particular group in a society changes from 16% to 26% or 2% to 8%, it means big things, big social changes, big strife, big bloody wars. It happens, then only these things happen. Let me talk about different regions of Asia, and then I think I'm a little bit through. South Asia, Muslims have gone from 25 to about 30%. And Christians from 1 to 4%, we'll talk a little more detail about this. Southeast Asia, Muslims have gone from 21 to 37%. And the Christians from 10 to 22. Major country of Southeast Asia is Indonesia, the largest country. In Indonesia, Muslims were only about 40% in 1900. They are 80% now. And in Southeast Asia, countries like Philippines, like South Korea, have become largely Christian. South Korea became about 40% Christian. Philippines is almost 90% Christian. Incidentally, I think this I should point out, South Korea is only one country where your time is bothering me. Can you take another 2 minutes? South Korea is one country where the proportion of Christians has come down a little in the last 10 years. And that is something which needs to be looked into. East Asia is interesting, and then there were 4% Muslims, and there are only 1% left. That is the only, China is the only country where they've actually reduced the number of Muslims. There were 24 million in 1900. There are only 21 million in 2010. But the Christians, they have not been able to, China is now about 10% Christian, which is showing here. Central Asia and West Asia, I'll forget. West Asia, important thing is that is one region where the Christianity has come down, and that's mainly because of Turkey. Turkey was very Christian, percentage was very Christian at the beginning of the 20th century. At the end of the 20th century, there's very few Christians left in Turkey. Now let us look at Bharatvarsha, South Asia, which is what we call Akhand Bharat. And here I want to point out only one number. In this region, there were 70% Hindus in 1900. And this number is a little wrong. There are 60% in 2010. There's a decline of 10 percentage points in one century. And if this process were to go on, where the Hindus will reach, our judgment is that by about 2050 at the latest, Hindus will be, in this region, Hindus will be 50% or less. And that is, every census data is showing that that's what will happen. That's all the numbers. This is the map of not Bharatvarsha, but of the Bharat which is left to us today. And in this Bharat, this part is almost entirely Muslim. This part, so much of it, this is great border. Here the Hindus are less than 50% already. This actually, when you show it to any historical philosopher, he will say that a country where you have this kind of, on the border you have this kind of situation, it takes extreme effort to save this area. This is our border, this is, the lower part is Muslim, Christian, and the upper part is Muslim. That's how this is looking like. There's also Christians from here to all this area, which is the tribal area of India, where the Christians are making great efforts. I have done this with a broad brush. I only want to say that though in Asia and in Bharatvarsha, the number of Hindus has come down drastically in the last century, still we are not extinguished, and that is also a great achievement. And Hindus have done a lot to save themselves, but to actually finally save yourself, you also need a positive state for yourself. Yesterday, Ashok Singhalji said that after 800 years, for the first time, we have got a Hindu Swabhimani Rajya in Bharat. And till you do not have a Hindu Swabhimani Rajya, these things will keep happening. So one of the important things for the Hindus to do, to make a response to this, will be to keep this Hindu Swabhimani Rajya going and not the opportunity lapse. And one small more point, I've taken too much time. I have done it with a very, very broad brush, but I was listening in the other economic forum. There are various small countries of the world, which I could not discuss today, where the Hindus, there are large numbers of Hindus. In the larger number, it becomes small, but for those regions, they are large, say in Fiji, in Guyana, in several, Suriname. And in all those parts, many of those Hindus are being forced to leave. And that is again a concern for the state of India. Thank you.